Welcome everybody. This is the first guest lecture of CY Advanced Studies for the academic year 2020-2021. Today we have the pleasure of hosting Salvatore Monteleone, who was a fellow in residence this year with us. He's actually coming to the end of his stay with us. Salvatore is a specialist in electronic and computer science, and today the topic of his talk will be about energy efficiency issues surrounding computer resources and computer architecture. So once again, welcome everybody to this online guest lecture, and Salvatore, the floor is yours. We have about an hour. We should stop at 1:30, because of the special format of the online lecture, we will be leaving the floor to Salvatore without questions. You can still ask questions in the chat. We can relay the questions during the talk of Salvatore, and then after Salvatore's presentation, we'll have a round for comments and interventions. Please make sure that you turn off your microphone when you're attending, and if you want to ask questions during the presentation, you can ask using the chat of the Zoom link, and after the presentation we'll be taking interventions. You have to use the raise hand button in the list of participants, and we'll distribute speaking turns according to your hand raising turn. Salvatore, thanks again for presenting, and the floor is yours.
Thanks a lot for the introduction. Thank you for hosting this guest lecture, the last of the 2020 fellow year residence, I think the first one for the new academic year.
So look down.
Thanks a lot. Okay, so today we will see which are the problems regarding the design, the application of emerging architectures and energy efficient architecture regarding network on chip. So the agenda will be first a brief introduction of what is the problem, then introduction of the network on chip paradigm. Then I will talk about emerging NOC architectures, and after that, design and simulation problems, and finally, I will conclude with applications. So, the continuous demanding for computing resources is growing in the last years, and we have seen that this kind of demand, computing demanding, is very interesting in two sample scenarios, which are the computing intensive applications, such as those for simulating meteor events, so weather simulations, to follow object in a video, so computer vision related problems, to design objects, so create rendering or 3D rendering of objects, but also regards some mobility scenarios, such as those related for example, to wearable or personal objects, such as photocameras, smartphones, toward the new problems, such as the autonomous driving, and the presence indeed of wearables computing devices. So to cope with the computation, the increasing computation request in these two different scenarios, we have to remember about what was defined as Moore's law, and then actually it was okay, it's actually more observation from the engineer Gordon Moore, who discovered that the amount of transistors, so the miniature electronic elements that are used to run computing elements, the amount of transistor on a single chip was increasing, was doubling every 12 months. After a couple of years, Gordon Moore changed a bit this law, stating that this amount of transistors, so the ability to put quantity of these switches are useful for computing doubled every couple of years. Starting from that point, consider that Gordon Moore was the founder of Fairchild Semiconductor and also one of the founders of Intel Corporation. Starting from that point, companies started following this kind of a rule. Again, it was not a real law, but a kind of observation that industries tried to cope with to maintain the market gain. The problem with Gordon Moore law is that when you start shrinking the size of this transistor, of these small switches that can let us to store the zero and one symbols for bits, we have an increasing problem with power density. So the problem is that the amount of energy dissipated by the use of this transistor when they shrink generates some heat that is not possible to manage when the elements becomes very, very miniaturized. So this problem led at some point with the Pentium family from Intel to move from a perspective on doubling the number of transistors of these small objects inside a single chip to use multiple processors inside computers. So for example, you can remember that now when you look for a personal computer, in a processor you can see the text like dual core, quad core. Mm-hmm. It means that instead of having one single processor, one single core, in which the number of transistors is increased year by year with the advance of technology, industry started to putting together more of them. Okay, because of this problem of heat dissipation, of power density. This trend became more evident with the years. It started around the 1990s and is more evident today. Also because we are facing with problem with very demanding computation, and there are new kind of processor systems with many core. So we are talking about the motion from one single core architecture, so one processor per computer, to multi-core architectures. Some current architectures use, for example, 2, 4, 16, also 1,000 cores. Okay, so it depends on the application domain and depends on the approach by the industry. In recent times, we are moving from these many core systems to from these multi-core systems, sorry, to many core systems. So with thousands of cores instead of some of them. So what is this network on chip paradigm? When you have a computer, usually you can connect it with other computers, creating what is called a network. For example, if you have two computers, you can connect in a point-to-point fashion, for example, this one custom connection. In this case, let's consider that they are five computers connected in a custom manner. So they are connected with different network interfaces to each other. This kind of connection can be also considered inside the processor. Okay, consider the processor is made of different components, components that are useful for computing and components that are useful for access and manage memory. So the problem is that how one system that has more than one computing element should cope with the problem of managing a lot of connections. So the first tentative as for personal computer networks was done with custom point-to-point connections. Then we moved to shared buses, so situation in which more cores were connected to a same line and then sharing the packets through this shared bus, through this shared line. And problem were rising. For example, how you can manage communication in which there are different priorities. Consider that when something runs inside a bus, the bus is just for that communication. It's not possible to use two of them to communication. So we move to hierarchical buses and then to bus matrices. Finally, moving toward very symmetrical, very geometrical connections. Called network on chip. Network on chip, the idea of network on chip was published in an academic journal around 2001. The article was stating that it was needed a change in the way we connected the elements inside a single processor, mimicking what happens for computer networks, okay, but also taking one important point, that designers, engineers, should not think about routing wires, so creating these different kind of connection, these different shapes of connections, but should think about routing the data, because data are the important things about computation. So when I made a computation, they have to share the information I have as a result. That will be an input for another computing element. Consider, for example, the photo camera scenario. A sensor takes an image, the light input, and converts it in a signal that is translated then to bits, to digitized information. And this information, for example, could be split in small squares to let different processors elaborate this image, for example, to correct some problems or to compress the image. And in this case, these kind of elements can communicate each other when the results are ready to compose at the end the full image, the whole image. So the important part is not how these elements that work with the image are connected, but which data, which part of the image they exchange. Okay, so as I said before, NOC was an attempt to scale down what was the experience with computer networks and was applied to system on a chip. A system on a chip is a chip, so an electronic device, an electronic board, in which you can find the full system. Full system means something that can perform from the start to the end a complete computation. So it can get inputs, it can work with them, can store intermediate information, and then create and share an output. So each element of this kind of systems is made of nodes, namely tiles. They are composed by three parts. They are composed by the computation core, a network interface, and a routing element, the one in red. So we have processing elements, the PE, and routing elements in this kind of connection. Network on chip has shows good properties for what concern the design efforts, because since they have a regular geometry, which is possible, and is possible to scale it to create bigger networks, instead of just having to design again every time the connection between a single cores, we have. With the network on chip, the chance to manage via software the exchange of data, so we can have a different and flexible quality of service. So I can say that one type of data can follow a faster route because it brings with it critical data, for example, data regarding safety information, like the temperature of the system is going too high, so we need to shut down a part of the system. They can provide higher bandwidth. It's possible to, for example, to run different flows of communication inside the network. And it's possible to reuse components like buffers, so elements in which you store data, routers and software and a piece of data, so that it's easier to design a new network on chip in at the moment you need one. There are two different classes of network on chips. The first one is the one I already presented, the homogeneous one. The second one is the heterogeneous, which is used in some more complex system in which you want to find a kind of trade-off between the custom connections and the very scalable homogeneous connection. Homogeneous are simpler, it's easy to replicate them because of their geometry, but they can suffer of loss of performance depending on the domain scenario. For example, autonomous driving, which are very different kind of data flows that need to be shared among computing elements, and can have low network resource utilization. On the other hand, heterogeneous networks are very can be very customized, and then big industry players such as car companies usually, when have to cope with very specific problems, they design their specific heterogeneous network on chip. So considering the in the case of automotive or avionics.
Excuse me, on the, can you get back to that picture? On the graph we can see that they are sort of visually heterogeneous because we have big tiles and small tiles. But could you elaborate a little bit on what sort of defines this heterogeneity? Is that
yes, okay.
Power? Is that,
okay. Okay. Consider, for example, this representation in which the green part is the processing element, the computation element, and the red part is a smaller element that just has to take the data and move on. Okay, these elements physically are created putting together, connecting together transistors, which are these small switches by which is possible to create logic functions. So say if this happens and this other happens, then the result is true or false. Okay, so consider that the basic computation starts like that. Okay, you can consider that this green area is, it could be the actual area in which cores are mapped in a silicon die, which is the output from the fabric, from the industry. So you consider that they have slices of silicon that in which these circuits, these transistors are printed, and then they are splitted. Okay, so one important parameter, for example, is the area. Okay, the fact that you can have a homogeneous area, it means that, okay, I consider that engineers, when they design this kind of system, since cannot cope with the billions of transistors, they cannot place them one by one, they usually make use of libraries. So software that says, okay, I need this component that is able to do sums. I need this component that is useful to do fast Fourier transformation, okay? And they place in their system. Okay, if the components are very generic and very similar, they just have to cope with one single component, and they can spread the same component around the system. If you are creating some, okay, but when you have a very generic component, it is useful to design the full system, but since it's generic, it's not the most the fastest component, the fastest configuration. Mm-hmm. Okay, it's like if you have a device that does something cabled electrically, or you have a processor that has to compute. The processor, the computer has to read a program, execute it, while the other approach is physical, okay, with the flow of electrons. So in this case, this heterogeneous network means that, for example, this part could be with a bigger amount of transistor because it is specialized to perform a fast Fourier transform, for example. Or another component could be specialized to manage memory. Bigger is the, much bigger is the amount of green part, bigger is the amount of transistor inside that part, because they occupy the same amount of space. that may depend on the technology. Okay, so with the advance of technology, the side of the square changes, but the proportion inside would remain the same.
That means heterogeneity means that you have all equal green parts. Okay.
Yeah. All okay. Equal green components.
Okay.
For example, in the other one, everything was a general purpose processor. In this one, one could be a digital signal processor. Another one could be a memory. Another one could be a input-output core to manage data from sensors and send data to actuators for controlling something. And being specific is more complicated to design it, but it's easier. The final application would be faster. Okay, so there are some factors that change the performance of our system, and they are topology, router architecture, so the red component architecture, the routing technique, which path should I follow to reach, for example, the first node here in this corner to this node, which are the possibilities that I can follow, and the flow control determines if a path could be followed or not, depending on its state. For example, a lot of data are passing through that path, so that are going to be slow because there is kind of traffic. Okay. Another important feature are this difference between direct topologies and indirect topologies. Direct topologies means, as we have seen in the previous slides, that every component as embedded the computing part and the communication part, the green part represented in green part for computing and the red part for communication. There are also different kind of topologies in which we separate, there is a what is called the separation of concerns. So some elements just compute, other elements just switch the data inside the network, which is the case of these topologies. So you can see they have different colors. The empty, the hollow squares are the computing elements, while the switches we move the data inside the network are in black. Then there are also mixed topologies. Each red dot or the gray switch, the gray square in the previous picture, is then a specific element that can take data from input, determine which is the path to follow, and output in the proper path. For example, this is a configuration for a square mesh, the first case we have seen. The square with, for example, 4x4 with 16 green square elements. And N, S, E, and W are the north, south, east, and west green elements, and P is the processing element, which is the local element. So a local element that wants to send data to the node in the north direction, send the data, this data pass through a crossbar, which reading the first part of the data determines that the output direction will be the north, for example. Other properties of this network on chip regard the routing, so how I choose the path to move data inside this this network, and if there are more paths that are good to reach the destination, which is the best one depending on the state of the network. So there are different kind of way to control the flow inside the network, the routing inside the network. Then the flow regards again the possibility to stop the flow of data in a specific direction because of there is a lot of traffic in that direction and the packets are slowing, or because there are no resources available, for example, this buffer in which data are stored temporarily, and so on. So there are also these problems related to flow. The data exchanged are made by messages in which and these messages are split into packets. Packets are then divided in header packets that say, this is the beginning of my data, the destination is node with ID 10, for example. Then there is the body part of data, and then there is a tail information that say this is the end of the data I'm transmitting now. Okay, so this is how a message is split. Now, the problem with this kind of architecture is that there are a lot of limitations, especially in terms of bandwidth, so the amount of data you can exchange in parallel, for example, and the limitation due to the shape of the network. For example, the mesh is a common case. To manage, and also due to the fact that, for example, in a mesh configuration, so consider the top layer of this network, to reach far away nodes, you have to jump across all the elements. So it's not possible to jump from this corner to this corner in one hop, but you have to find your path through the network, for example, following this side or going following the borders. So the path depends on the routing strategy and on flow control. But sometimes they are not enough to manage properly the network, the information needed. And then it's possible to consider new topologies, new technologies that are embedded in these network on chips. They usually represent a second layer put on top of the network on chip. So consider the first layer is that one wired, and then we have optical network on chip that can use optical fibers to transmit data. Radio frequency network on chip that can use zigzag antennas, for example, or waveguided path. And then hybrid NOCs that can mix different technologies. So the problem is the one I depicted before. If we consider, for example, this shape that is called mesh, we have a diameter of the network, which means actually this is the average path of the network, which is given by this formula. Because if we want to take from one single node to each other node, we have different paths. For example, we have one hop here, but we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 hop to reach the from top left to down bottom right corner. So this is the first motivation. With wireless, for example, NOC, which are the ones I was working at the beginning of my research after the PhD, with wireless NOC, for example, it's possible to do the same path with one single hop if these nodes contain a wireless interface. What is a wireless interface? Practically, we add a component with a radio interface that is connected with some of the other nodes in the network. So for example, when a tile, so the green component we have seen before, wants to transmit to a far node, he can take a shortcut through this little component that can talk to other little components that share the same radio frequency channel, and then within a single hop, it can reach the far destination. This system could be also used for broadcasting messages. Mm-hmm. So if I want to share with all the nodes in a network the information that I obtain from my single computation. Another architecture, which is similar to the previous one, but uses not zigzag antennas, but a waveguided radio frequency, is the one I started studying here at CERJ University, and in particular at the ETIS Lab in ENSEA. That has been proposed by the group I worked with, led by Professor Emmanuel Burdel and Professor Giordano Lorandel, and it is represented in this kind of image. So consider that in this system we have 1,024 cores, so 1,024 elements that can perform computation, general computation. They are divided in 32 clusters, each one contains 32 processing elements, and at the center of the cluster, of each cluster, there is a radio hub, this component, enhanced component, that can manage wireless communication. So in their prototype, because this architecture was firstly designed and then prototyped within a European project, and within this architecture, we started making experiment to test what happens with energy efficiency, using, for example, different routing algorithm or changing parameters of a given routing algorithm. In particular, to use this architecture, one of the requests was to introduce this OFDMA technique. OFDMA is a technique that lets you share at the same time data from different users. So in this case, data coming from different cores, so that there is no awaiting, an active waiting from cores that want to send data. So if core 1 and core 2 want to send data, they don't have to wait each other, wait for each other, but they can send data in parallel. This is the model for the OFDMA channel. We made changes in a simulator. And this simulator was adopted to understand how to improve the architecture, if it's possible to improve the architecture also, without the necessity of creating new prototypes, because prototypes are costly and simulation are quite cheap. And if they are done in a good way, they let you keep a lot of money back. So what was useful was to create a tool to test different configuration of parameters in the given architecture. So what we have done is, considering the normal design space exploration architecture, in which you start from an application, you map the application to the cores. So you say this multiplication is given, is assigned to the first core, the FFT is assigned to the nth core, and so on. You define the architecture size and other parameters. So for example, these clusters and the number of cores and depth of buffers, and so on. And then at this point, you can simulate your architecture, create an analysis, and change something in the architecture to make it better, and give new inputs to the application to understand what happens if it changes. So design space exploration is a technique very common. There are works starting from 2005 suggesting the use of this kind of technique. It helps to have a good design quality while having a medium design effort. Okay, so it's very good to launch a product in the market in a short time. The mapping problem I mentioned before is represented in this graph. Okay, it's just some functions, some tasks indicated by T and then a number are mapped to specific cores. And this problem is a big one, is very complicated to copy with depth, actually. Okay, why am I here? Because I worked with other people at University of Catania to this simulator, Noxim, a Nox simulator. This simulator is cycle accurate. It's possible to simulate what happens at every cycle of the CPU of the processor simulated, thanks to a library, SystemC, that helps the developer, in this case us from the team in Catania, to cope with signal and high level electronics, let's say. This simulator is made for performance and power estimation. So the results are regarding the size of the green blocks and how much power is needed to do a task. Okay, and there is the chance to use wireless transmission simulation. In fact, I came here in France to help the team, the local team, to change, to enhance an Oxim simulator and adapt it to their use case. Okay, so the first part was the simulation that was already available in Oxim. The second part with their specific architecture and the implementation of FDMA is what I had to do in this year. Okay. The problem with just Noxim we have seen is that in some cases it's necessary to simulate the full application, the real application, because Noxim is a simulator that presents results with standard common ways to generate traffic, so to generate data. And to have better results, we had to create a simulation framework that was able to use also real application. For example, instead of using the standard benchmark, the standard fast Fourier transform, I can use my specific algorithm and I want to see if that works the same way. Okay, but that algorithm creates different data. So we want to see if we get different results. For this reason, it was proposed a simulation framework. The paper regarding this framework is in this moment under revision, coupling the Noxim simulator with another simulator called Snipper that is able to create a simulation of real applications. So the output of the and we resolve the application problem. The output of this system level simulator is able to is converted then to input for our simulator, and at the end of the simulation it's possible to adjust, to refine the parameters to get a more accurate result. So in this way we are doing the loop of the design space exploration. We can change in this process parameters and we can update them and see if the results, save the results and see which is better, which configuration is better with real application, because the real application output is given by this simulator. Okay, so for what concern applications, consider that at the beginning I said we have seeing increasing demanding of computing resources, computing intensive applications, and this is also due to the spread of applications that exploit artificial intelligence, so AI. So, and in particular, this is the case for applications that use machine learning through deep learning technique. Now, artificial intelligence is a set of technologies, techniques that let machine mimic human behavior. With machine learning, we talk about machines that are able, that are enabled to improve their results through experience. With deep learning, we mean the techniques to manage machine learning and then artificial intelligence for a very specific case through neural networks. Okay, so this is the difference between these three concepts. Some of the most common applications are computer vision, so visual data processing, or speech and audio processing, for example, to translate text, autonomous driving, which is also a combination of other techniques, for example, computer vision. Also in this case, there are two main domains of interest. The very small wearable device, constrained device, such as, for example, also our smartphone, and the high-performance computing. This because data centers, for example, that need to perform high-performance computing can benefit from specific hardware designed for them to reduce the heat problem. One of the major costs inside a data center is the cooling. So cooling the environment is one of the major problems. So this kind of accelerators can, this kind of design can help in both cases. Rapidly, a neural network is something designed in this way, in which we have some inputs, for example, an image, so the pixel of an image, that are processed through a black box, here defined as a hidden layer, and this black box is able to give us an output which is a prediction of something. Or now with neural networks we have we can usually perform two kind of computation. One is classification. So if we have a set of initial images, we can see, we can say that an input image is one of the available set. So I can distinguish a cat from different kind of cats, for example, or a cat from another animal, given the set of classes, so animals or cats. The other prediction type is to get single point results, so real numbers. The difference between this network and this network is just that the black box is bigger, so and it takes more steps to get the prediction, to output the prediction. It means also that the prediction would be more accurate, let's say. The single element of a neural network is the perceptron. The perceptron model is presented here, in which we have the inputs that reach this model. And this model just do a very simple operation. It takes the inputs to the neuron, it multiplies them in a scalar way, in a scalar manner with these weights, sums a bias, and then output a result through what is called an activation function. Okay, so the formula to calculate this output is presented here. Okay, for example, let's say we want to find a model to determine the price of an house starting from its size. Okay, we can have different points, different sizes from a catalog, and then see their prices. And then at some point we can see that there is a shape, there is a function that can fit that curve. This is the most simple function that can be used to fit a curve. And it is one of the functions now used inside neural networks to do the prediction. So in this case, we have a network with just a neuron. The input is the size. This function is the ReLU function. And the prediction is the price of the apartment. So if I found this size here, it will give something related to this price, for example. Now, it's possible to create complex networks just thinking about the properties that can be in input and which are the characteristics of the house pricing and get a better prediction. Okay? In this case, we are giving a meaning to these connections. What happens with neural networks is that many times these properties, not the input are known, but these properties are not so easy to extrapolate. Okay? So inputs, outputs, the prediction in the middle the layers. Okay, the application are many. For example, we've seen the real estate application from on features and having a prediction of the output price. We have classification, so photo tagging. So in a photo, I can recognize different objects or people or animals or other. And machine translation, autonomous driving, and so on. What's interesting from this perceptual model is that it practically does this simple operation. Okay, so this math is translated to this. So we just have multiplication and sums. These operations are called multiply and accumulate, MAC. These are 90% of the operation done inside a neural network. So here we have all these operations for each perceptron. We have two modes of using this network. The first one is the training. We have to give for each weight a value. So we need to train our model to work with the problem. Okay, we give an input, we give some test results, so we give we try some shots with something that should predict and we know what should be the result. And the other way instead is using the inference. So we can, after we train the network, use an unknown input and get a prediction, a real prediction. This is the function that we want to put into wearables, into the smartphones or constrained devices, because this is the process which is less computation demanding and could be easily performed for augmented reality, virtual reality application, and so on. Current phones already do this kind of operation, for example, integrating specifically designed AI chips. Most of them use this kind of AI functionalities for the images, for taking photos, which is the most requested features from users. Here there are some models, common and famous models of neural networks used to classify images. So distinguish between the first one, for example, is to distinguish from handwritten letters. Okay, so I write a check, I give it to the ATM in the bank, the machine. It reads, it takes a photo of the check and distinguish the letters, the cipher inside the check. Okay, these are very simple compared to the new ones, but groundbreaking at the first time network. And consider that this network, just this network needs 60,000 weights. So there are 60,000 of these blue lines. Every weight is a real number that is stored with 32 bits. You can see also the amount of multiplying some operation that this network just distinguish between 1, 2, 3, till 9, and 0, and the letters, which amount of multiply and accumulate in the last row, how much of this kind of operation should perform. And you can see what happens with really big networks. So we have a very large amount of this data. So how can we measure if a system like this could be well designed in or is well designed in an hardware? So we have some parameters, for example, the accuracy, so the quality of data, the throughput, how many data we can process, the latency, how many time there is between one result and the other. For example, in autonomous driving, latency should be very important. We should get the results rapidly, so in real-time process, and so on. And the objectives are to increase the throughput, so use more data while reduce the time between them, and avoid the unnecessary operations, multiplying accumulation, increase the utilization of processing elements. So if in that mesh we have seen before with 16 cores, just three of them work at 100%, and the others are shut down, the system is not well balanced. And the problem with these systems is that they are dominated by memory subsystem and communication subsystem. And the network on chip we have seen is a communication subsystem. It resolves problems related to communication of data. So we can apply this DNN neural network model to network on chip architectures. Mm-hmm. There are three steps. The first one is to use the inputs, so the images, for example, coming from the webcam, stored in the main memory and switch and move them inside the network on chip to the first element, which is called the memory interface. So it can call, talk with the memory. It then distributes to other elements, to each element, their task. Okay, so for example, we split an image in different parts and every processing element work with a single part. And at the end, the output is moved again from the network on chip to the main memory, and that can be accessed by the main processor of our system, for example. So to make this process rapid, more rapid, we worked with a team here in France and in Italy. We work to some compression techniques to try to move a smaller amount of data, just not because we cut the number of weights, but because we reduce the size to transfer the same amount of information. So we designed with two different works models to work with this with the models that we have seen in the previous table. And the main approaches in this work, for example, is to cluster the weights and then use a kind of representative point. So it could be also substituted with a k-mean algorithm, for example. And the other approach is tested also in hardware. It's able to compress the a point, a weight, taking into account the previous ones. So using some trigonometric operations, it can reduce the amount of data to describe next points based on the previous ones. Okay, with this I completed this run. And the people mentioned here are the people from the group here in at ETI Sensea and Sergi Paris Université. I would like to thank them for hosting me in this here. The other people are Maurizio Palesi and Davide Patti from University of Catania. You don't know them. They were the team who supported me in my previous work. And thank you. The final greeting.
Thank you very much.
So if there are questions.
And the other university you are going now is, the name is?
University of Enna Core.
Another spot for this kind of
and to just to it could be interested there is
to see the size of the unit
the size of depends on what you are how many course you need okay to consider that the transistor size usually is around of 60-70 atoms of silicon. So with the current technology, the current common technology. So depending on what kind of function you are implementing, the size then varies, depending on the number of transistors you need to use. I was just to advertise this symposium in which it starts tomorrow, and I'm organizing a workshop inside this symposium about network on chip architectures. I didn't publicize it inside this environment just because you need to pay a registration and it's hosted by them, so it was really complicated to and people. So this workshop will be on Sunday, and there are some interesting, talks that could be.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Salvatore. So maybe there are questions from the audience, from the remote audience. You can see if there are some hands raised already.
Did you want chat?
Chat?
Rudolf?
I'm currently looking at the chat. If there's any question,